Greetings. Welcome to Organic Wellness Crusade. I'm Dr. Henry L. N. Anderson, your host, and I'm very, very excited today about my very special guest, Dr. T.C. Fry, President, Life Science Institute, Austin, Texas. Today, Dr. Fry and I have been discussing his new book, The Great AIDS Hoax. Great AIDS Hoax. Is that about right?
That is correct.
You're going to be very, very shocked by some things that Dr. Fry says. You're going to be very educated by other things that he says. And you're going to be very, very interested, I think, in this portion of our discussion. Dr. Fry, would you please start by just telling us a little bit about your background? I know that the things that you're going to say are going to first open you up to criticism. People are going to want to know, where does he come from? What gives him the right to say these things? What is his educational background? So let's dispel those anxieties right away.
Well, first, I would say I'm self-educated. I dropped out in my senior year at high school. And I like to say that I don't face the handicap of having been formally miseducated or brainwashed. I have done my researches and learning independently and have not been influenced by traditional, or shall we say, perpetrated and perpetuated misconceptions in many areas, and especially in the health area in which I presently function. Yes, I'm the president of Life Science, and at Life Science, we've developed an educational program, one of which is called the Nutritional and Health Sciences course. This course has achieved considerable notoriety, or I should say fame, and two of its foremost graduates are Harvey and Marilyn Diamond, authors of the best-selling book Fit for Life. The course has been translated into French, and it has been adopted as curriculum at the Department of Medicine, University of Paris in France. I was there helping dedicate it, and they teach it to 1,200 medical students as natural therapy. And I was honorarily awarded there a degree of professor of natural therapy. And of course, when I came back here, I was also awarded a degree by City University of Los Angeles as Doctor of Science. So I'm not without degrees, but I do not call myself doctor, though many people do.
Well, we'll call you doctor.
Yes, the word doctor, incidentally, does not mean to treat people. It means to teach people. That's what the word doctor means. It comes from the Latin word docere.
Well, that makes you a super doctor then.
Well, all right. In Europe, they call doctors what we call professors.
Yes. Well, Dr. Fry, since that is most appropriate for you, because you do spend most of your professional life teaching others, mm-hmm. and as a student of yours myself, I know about your teachings, and I know a lot of what you want your students to learn. We are facing a very, very serious crisis in our country and in the world. We've got people who are dying from AIDS. We have establishments that are housed to provide care, research, and other supportive activities for AIDS. The Congress of the United States of America has been encouraged to vote unlimited funds for AIDS. And Dr. T.C. Fry comes to Organic Wellness Crusade, and he tells us, and he tells our audience, and he tells the American people, and he tells the world that this is all a hoax.
That's correct.
Dr. Fry, you're on the hot seat. Explain yourself for us.
It is a hoax indeed. It was a well-planned program. The last successful, big success that the Centers for Disease Control had in promoting a hoax was the polio hoax. They tried many others, and one of them blew up in their face. We all know about the swine flu farce. They promoted that. with the idea that we should all take flu shots for here and the hereafter against swine flu to prevent it, just as we do in polio. That's the name of the game. The bottom line is the increase in sales of drugs. And the Centers for Disease Control, CDC for short, promote these scams. And as we know, the swine flu was a scam. Several of them they've tried and they didn't go over big. For instance, Legionnaire's disease promotion never went over big at all. But then, back in 1978, they dismantled a disease called syphilis. Most people around have memories about syphilis, but you don't hear about it anymore.
Right.
Well, syphilis has four stages, presumably. First stage was the development of papillae, or sores in the genital area. And the second stage is even more serious, where there are lymphadenitis, that is, affections of the lymph glands. And the third stage was where there was diarrhea, fevers, vomiting, pneumocystic carini, that's a type of pneumonia, and many other symptoms. And the fourth stage is degenerative symptoms, wherein death may actually occur. Now, as I say, back in 1978, they dismantled the syphilis disease. And the first stage was reintroduced as herpes genitalis. After all, we all remember when a time when herpes genitalis wasn't around.
Yes.
It just sort of got sprung on us, and it had 23 million instant sufferers.
Yes.
And of course, prior to that, they suffered from syphilis. But then a second and third stages and fourth stages were introduced, and they had already been introduced prematurely before the Center for Disease Control took charge. It was called GRID, and it had one specific purpose: to destroy the burgeoning gay rights movement of the time. They were being quite successful, and it looked like they would get a legislative act equivalent of the Equal Rights Amendment women were trying for. And so a lot of powerful forces developed what they called gay-related immunodeficiency disease. Now, this is a disease that many gays get, only a small number when you consider there's so many millions of gays, but it's a disease they get if you're heavy on drugs, especially uppers and downers and quaaludes and many other things, poppers, which the gays were taking in great doses to get better, what we call higher highs.
Yes.
And of course, the gays were well known for their tendency to syphilis. But for that, they took a lot of antibiotics. And when this came on the scene, when AIDS was introduced, the Centers for Disease Control appeared to be baffled. Yet they seemed to know enough to call it AIDS in advance. It was a catchy acronym. And you have to know a lot about a disease before you can say it is acquired. But I went to a Merck manual. This is the Physician's Bible. It's published by the Merck Sharp Dohme Company.
Yes, I have one.
And I went to the Dorland's Medical Dictionaries and Tabor's Dictionaries. And I started looking up these terms, and lo and behold, the symptoms of the disease called AIDS has been in the Merck manual since 1952. And it had very definite listings of what the causes are. And among those causes are blood transfusions, immunosuppressant drugs, antibiotics, cytotoxic drugs, alcohol, radiation therapy, anti-metabolite therapy, and phagocytotic disorders, and chemotaxis, and hypercatabolism, nephrotic syndrome, protein-losing enterotherapy. In other words, there was any number of things that would cause the destruction of the white blood cell complement, which constitutes what's called AIDS. And what the Centers for Disease Control did was to take old diseases and gradually include them under the AIDS banner. Now, it was significant that the people who were dying of this were mostly gays. That is no longer true. But at the beginning it was, because the people who died were those who were suffering the symptoms of what was called AIDS. Actually, they were immunodeficiency diseases, which have been around for ages. They were suffering it, and they were going to the hospital. And believe it or not, they were treating them with chemotherapy, which is listed as one of the immunosuppressant drugs. I mean, the whole round of it was immunosuppressant. And of course, it's no surprise that they died. But the gay rights movement was pretty strong. They communicate with each other. And they begin to realize that their poppers, uppers, and downers, and their drug habits were causing this, as well as heroin and other intravenous drugs. And they warned their members, and that is the homosexuals whom they served. And the homosexuals started getting off these drugs. Moreover, they found out that there's alternative ways of therapy that weren't deadly. And it was like a death sentence if you went to the hospital and went through chemotherapy, which further immunosuppressed your white blood cell complement. So they stopped going. In 1987, for the first time, when deaths from AIDS are supposed to be going up, the homosexual population death from AIDS dropped by over 1,500. And in 1988, it dropped another 1,000. So the people dying from AIDS that are homosexuals has gone way down, simply because if they do get the symptoms that are called AIDS, that is immunosuppressed conditions, they, at least most of them, are wise enough not to go to a hospital anymore. Because going to a hospital and getting the standard treatment is a death sentence, because they give you massive immunotherapy. And of course, what's this great AIDS hoax all about? If you know the history of the Centers for Disease Control and its propensity for launching these phony disease scares, taking other diseases that's already existed. For instance, polio was, before the onset of polio, was called infantile paralysis. Right. It was called viral meningitis, aseptic meningitis, and it was Coxhatch's disease, and a lot of other thrown together, and they were included under the polio banner. In 1955, on May the 12th, there was introduced the salt vaccine. What most people don't know, that was simultaneous with the introduction of the vaccine, the Centers for Disease Control introduced new guidelines for physician diagnosis of polio. Henceforth, the symptoms of polio were only paralysis, and it had to be in evidence 60 days before they could call it polio. So that effectively wiped out polio, even if they hadn't had a vaccine, because when by the new guidelines, it was only a few hundred cases a year of polio instead of 50 or 60,000. And what they call polio before that is aseptic meningitis and the other diseases, were reverted to the old diagnoses.
So they redefine and therefore eliminate and manipulate.
That's correct. That's what Centers for Disease Control do. They brainwash us. They get us all in a dither through the press. They create a real hysteria and a panic. And everybody is afraid their children are going to get paralysis and everything. And when the polio vaccines came out, they rushed to get their children vaccinated and protected. But something they don't tell you, that the rate of polio went up about 3 or 4 times after the introduction of the disease, but was diagnosed under the other symptoms to which reverted. And the course of paralysis was more, but it's still only a few hundred cases a year. So that, but the whole idea was to establish the basis for selling you a polio vaccine from here to hereafter. Now the salt vaccine is very deadly. It killed more people, it killed more children than the swine flu vaccine. But they had that one under control. It didn't get out of hand. But lots of children were killed by the salt vaccine, so they quietly discontinued it and substituted what they call the Sabin oral vaccine. See, they don't care what they're selling is the name of the game. And of course, it does not prevent any of the symptoms called polio if you take into consideration that aseptic meningitis and other designations were what they were calling polio.
Dr. Fry, excuse me for a moment.
Yes.
I can just see our audience getting a little bit antsy out there.
Uh-huh.
You made a few very glaring accusations. I want to zero in on those and give you a chance to individually respond in detail.
Mm-hmm.
For example, you just said a very touching thing, and that is that the salt vaccine that a lot of mothers felt was a gift from heaven killed a lot of their children. Now, that's a very serious accusation.
Well, it's not a serious accusation. It's a matter of statistics. It's on record of doing so. You heard about 1957 when they said a bad lot of vaccines from Cutter's Laboratory in San Francisco was killing the children. Well, the truth is, the salt vaccine itself was totally disastrous, and it was withdrawn. And the salt vaccine, I mean, the Sabin vaccine was substituted instead. This was in the polio, but I mean, we still take polio vaccine. That's the name of the game, the bottom line, so to speak. And of course, there's other fallout from this. Now, if you go to the AIDS hoax, the Centers for Disease Control, especially the sexually transmitted disease section, of which Dr. James Curran headed, was in much danger of being cut back under the Reagan administration. So their situation called for bringing in something sensational, not only to maintain themselves, but perhaps to increase their budget and increase their research department and increase the salaries and importance of the people there. And of course, they had already cooking on the back burner, so to speak, when they dismantled syphilis back in the late 70s. And it reintroduced the first part of syphilis, the first stage, as genitalis herpes, or herpes genitalis. So you see, the stage was being set already, and along come these opportunists and call the homosexuals' drug habits, which were killing them, call it GRID. And all drugs are immunosuppressants. They suppress the body's white blood cells. They destroy them because the white blood cells are the body's first line of defense in the fluids. It goes after poisons in the blood, even if they're destroyed in the act of apprehending and trying to eject these poisons. And that's exactly why they're immunosuppressant. They die in the process. They die in millions and billions trying to apprehend and get these poisons out of the system.
A person says, I've got a headache, I'm going to take an aspirin. What is that person doing?
Well, he's suppressing the symptoms of a highly toxic body. You get a headache only if your body is toxic. And the body responds to this toxicity by a process of trying to keep the blood to the brain pure. And what it does is to place a barrier in the bloodstream. It constricts and it causes tremendous pressures in the head. And this is what causes the headaches, tremendous pressures in the head. And it's not in the brain. The brain has the pressures too, but we don't feel it in the brain. We feel it only on the nerves exterior to the skull.
Dr. Fry, I want to go back just a moment to the salt vaccine.
Yes.
Dr. Jonas Salk, as I recall, was awarded a Nobel Peace Prize.
That's correct.
Should he burn? Well, should he burn his prize?
Well, he's actually a great charlatan. And of course, the drug industry, the pharmaceutical industry, which is a part of a cartel that controls our media and everything else worth control in this country, doesn't unmake heroes. He's still a hero in their books, but actually, his vaccine was a disaster.
Are you suggesting that the Center for Disease Control in Atlanta, Georgia, is a pawn of the drug industry, the pharmaceutical industry?
I'm not saying or suggesting it is. I'm saying it is.
Well,
it serves not only its own bureaucratic purposes, but it's a pawn. It's a pawn of the pharmaceutical industry.
It is not a private, it is not a governmental agency?
Centers for Disease Control is a governmental agency, and it acts as if it were agency or a association for the pharmaceutical industry in reality. But it does have a lot of legitimate functions.
I see.
But by and large, it's not needed. It was set up to serve the pharmaceutical industry at government expense. I mean, that's not unusual because the cartel that controls this country takes in more than half the national budget to itself. For instance, the Federal Reserve System is not federal at all. It's privately owned. And it pays about $200 billion in interest a year to the government pays this to the Federal Reserve System, and this is a private income. It has nothing to do with our people. And that is really pass-through money. The Internal Revenue Service collects this money and passes it straight through to the Federal Reserve System, a private banking system. And when you go to the defense industry, and you go to the medical Medicare and all the other government-sponsored programs. When you go to the FDA and you go to the CCI and all the other public health service agencies set up under government sponsorship and paid for by the American people, but they're actually serving private industry, especially the pharmaceutical drug and hospital industry.
Dr. Fry, you just said in your own way that Peter Jennings, who's paid $3 million a year, Walter Cronkite, and all of these wonderful newscasters that we've grown up watching, are actually telling us lies over the public media. Now, they can't, these men are well-trained, they're highly educated, they're very professional, as you know. They can't possibly know that they're telling us lies. They can't possibly know that when they repeat a news release, for example, from the Center for Disease Control, that this is a big lie that they're perpetrating upon the American people.
They probably wouldn't know it at all. They are well paid. They know who pays them and what they get paid to say and what they shouldn't touch. See, there's a lot of no-nos in areas you don't touch. But they know what they're supposed to report and highlight, and they're controlled very much by the networks. And these networks are controlled by the cartel, which controls everything else worth controlling in this country. The cartel actually outright owns the pharmaceutical industry and our chemical industries, including our organic indisposition, I should say, that is the pesticide chemical companies. They own those outright and they promote them. And it's quite a blow to them when the media, which they also control, don't get the message right and start knocking their pesticides. It used to be promoted and they try and keep it under control. However, the cartel at the moment is beginning to realize that maybe the health of the American people is important after all. We notice that they're really trying to get the American people to stop smoking. This cartel realizes that the American people who smoke cost them about $5,000 per worker per year in the workplace, whereas when they consider their profits from the sale of cigarettes, it's only about $150 per person per year. And it's not nearly comparable to what it's costing them on the other side of the ledger. So they've really came out against smoking now.
That's very interesting. But now I want to look at the audience for a moment.
Yes.
Here we are watching our 6 o'clock news programs. We're believing what we hear on the media. We know that people are dying of AIDS because almost all of us know someone who's died of AIDS. We see press releases coming out of the Center for Disease Control. We hear the same thing being said in all parts of the country. We hear our own medical professionals uttering the same things. And then we have Dr. T.C. Fry, who comes and says to us, Rock Hudson did not die of AIDS. That his name, the piano player, Liberace, did not die of AIDS. And the man on the street is very, very confused. The woman in the beauty shop now doesn't know what to think. Dr. Fry, help the common, everyday American who is dependent upon information mainly from the electronic media and the newspaper media. Help the common person on the street understand what's going on here. Now, I realize that we're not going to be able to finish all of this, and we're just going to continue. If you have the time, I want you to continue with me.
First, let us understand that what is called AIDS is what Rock Hudson and Liberace did indeed die of. They call it AIDS, but before that, it was called by the names. I mean, if I look at my list here, it was called egg gamma globin anemia in the case of children. It's called, it was called in the Merck manual, it was called CIDS, combined immunodeficiency syndrome. And it was called IDS, immunodeficiency syndrome. It was called agranulocytosis, which means a shortage of granulocytes. These are basophils, xenophils, and other blood components, that is white blood cell components. It was called alymphocytosis, DiGeorge syndrome, and it was called granulocytopenia, Kaposi's sarcoma, leukocytopenia, lymphocytopenia, neutropenia, pancytopenia, splenic deficiency syndrome, thymic lymphoplasia. In other words, these names are some of the names that were applied to conditions presently covered by the banner of AIDS. And the people don't read the Merck manual as rule, but it's been on the scene for many years. And it came in 1952 into the Merck manual as immunodeficiency diseases. And when you go back and look at the old manuals and the current manuals, you'll find that they've done a switcheroo. I mean, it is very odd that in the 14th edition of the Merck manual on page 288, they talk about immunodeficiency diseases, and it gives all this information that I'm speaking about, the causes, so forth. When you come to the 15th edition, on page 288, it has AIDS.
I see. Dr. Fry, it has been a pleasure discussing with you up to this point. Obviously, there's a lot more to be said, and we're not through. And I'm glad you have some more time to come back with us for some more discussion. When we come back with Dr. Fry, we want to discuss the virus theory and let Dr. Fry relate that to the current discussion on AIDS. We thank you for joining us, and we'll join you again. Dr. Fry.
Thank you.
It is just a pleasure to have you. We'll continue this discussion.
Well, we will. When do we do it?
We're going to do it after just a week. Well, just know that I had a look around.
Keep it rolling.
Stand by and do your busy. No. And everywhere that Mary went. Well,
we
you know the story.
Yeah.
All this has just been just been a great discussion. I'm looking forward to getting into the other aspect of it. Greetings. I'm Dr. Henry Allen Anderson, your host of Organic Wellness Crusade. And with me on this segment is Dr. T.C. Fry. Dr. Fry and I have been discussing his new book, AIDS, the Great Hoax. Dr. Fry has advanced a number of ideas that are new, alarming, shocking, unbelievable even. Dr. Fry, for example, has postulated, he says he can prove it, that the CDC, the Center for Disease Control in Atlanta, manufactured the disease AIDS, just as it manufactured polio and many other diseases. So you know, we've been having an interesting discussion. Dr. Fry, the layperson, the common person, approaches disease from a catch-it point of view. You catch a cold, you catch AIDS, you catch mumps, you catch measles. Is that true, or is that also manufactured? And if it is manufactured, Dr. Fry, I want you to really explain it so that the person out there in the audience can understand what's behind that.
Okay, we're talking about contagion. Now, contagion exists for thousands of years, the concept of it. And originally it applied to demons. People were possessed of demons, and they had people who drove demons out as a profession. And eventually part became the priestcraft, and another part became the medical profession. But demonology was really the science of ancient times. And they believed that diseases were evil spirits and demons that possessed people. But the concept of disease evolved, but the idea that disease passed from person to person as demons or evil spirits or whatever continued to exist. And of course, when the medical system was commercialized, they kept and exploited old concepts. Now, contagion, of course, is a myth. There are many medical concepts that are outright myths that are perpetuated perpetually simply because they yield big profits to the cartel that controls the medical profession. Now, when it comes to contagion itself, if I were to line up 100 people and I gave each one an emetic and all 100 of them vomited, you'd say, Jesus, this vomiting is a very contagious disease. But the truth is, they've only demonstrated scientifically one thing. Similar organisms subjected to similar influences react similarly. And to put it in very blunt terms, similar organisms indulging the same bad habits get the same bad results. So when it comes to diseases, the causes of it are rife. They're what is contagious. We are likely to pick up other people's bad habits and practice them. In this country, disease is rampant. It's the most diseased country in the world. And of course, we have more bad habits than any other country in the world. And most people are sick in some way or other. Over 50% of our peoples have a chronic disease.
I have a mother out here in the audience, excuse me, who says, I just moved to a new community and my six-year-old has been kept out of school 6 weeks because I have not been able to get to have her measles shot, and they won't let her in school. And you telling me that all I'm doing is taking my child to what?
Well, the child will not get the measles for that reason, for lack of a shot. The truth is that shots tend to devitalize a person, such that any such vital action as measles, which is only a body eliminative activity, will not occur. However, measles is not the problem. They want to give you what they call DPT, mm-hmm. and a whole series of shots, and they're compulsory, not really compulsory. If you don't have to keep your child out of school in the state of California, it's just a matter of conscience as to whether you get your child vaccinated or not, and all you have to do is just send in a letter to your school superintendent or the school nurse saying that it's contrary to my beliefs that my child should be vaccinated, and they will exempt your child from that alone. In other states, they're not so fortunate.
Move to the larger issue for me for a moment, Dr. Fry. What is it then that causes the measles? How does the child catch the measles, or the mumps, or the whooping cough?
Measles is a simple disease whereby the body eliminates toxic materials through the skin. And all diseases are body efforts. They're initiated and conducted by the body to eliminate poisons that have become extraordinary to its ability to eliminate normally through the kidneys, the skin, the bowels, and the lungs.
No parent would willingly feed his or her child, I mean no caring parent would willingly feed his or her child poisons.
That's right.
What are these poisons? How are they getting into our children?
When it comes to poisoning, the first commandment of eating is thou shalt not poison thyself. But unfortunately, when Americans eat, they're eating a plethora of poisons every day. It is estimated that the average American poisons themselves between 10 and 60 times a day. We know every time you smoke a cigarette, you're poisoning yourself. Every time you take a cup of coffee, you know you're poisoning yourself. When you take alcohol, you know you're poisoning yourself. It's a very bad poison.
Well, is tea any different from coffee?
Well, tea is really the same as coffee. They have just different names for the same substance, which is a type of caffeine. But there are many other things with which we poison ourselves. I mean, soft drinks are rife with poisons, like phosphoric acid and caffeine. And of course, in the case of Coca-Cola formulas, they have the coca leaves from which a derivative is made, and it's quite toxic. It gives you a big kick. I mean, we eat and everything for the kicks we can get out of it rather than for nourishment. And soft drinks are a disaster, just like alcohol and alcoholic beverages.
I've read that Coca-Cola, the secret ingredient in Coca-Cola as far back as 1906, was actually cocaine.
That's correct. It comes from the same leaf that cocaine is derived.
So if we bring this full cycle now to 1989, we have people who are dying of AIDS. We have very responsible people who know that their good friends have caught AIDS. We have a recent lawsuit where a person has been awarded $22 million because his health was impeded or endangered by a person who had a quote-unquote communicable disease that he did not reveal. Would you comment on that?
Okay, we're talking about Rock Hudson.
Yes.
And of course his homosexual partner.
Yes.
His homosexual partner doesn't have AIDS, incidentally.
Right.
He was just so-called exposed to it, and on that basis, he won a jury award of the $22 million. In fact, just about everything Rock Hudson had left over in his estate. But the truth is that diseases aren't communicated. I repeat, diseases result from deficiencies are from toxic materials. When you have a deficiency, your body becomes poisoned anyway. Now, the reason that you have an immunodeficiency, that is a shortage of white blood cells in your blood, is because so many of them are destroyed in apprehending and ejecting toxic materials, especially from drugs like heroin, cocaine, poppers, uppers and downers, and things like this, which the gay crowd were so fond of, but which they're giving up pretty much now.
Are you saying, Dr. Fry, that if in fact Rock Hudson had AIDS, his lover, unless he were doing the same kinds of habits as Rock Hudson, was in no danger ever, never?
No danger. And the idea that a virus causes this is strictly, it's never been proven. In fact, if the proof means anything, it means it doesn't.
What exactly is a virus?
Well, a virus is an evil spirit, but I'll tell you what they've settled on it. Virus was already in the last part of the last century. beginning to be referred to as a cause of disease, because it was already evident that the bacterial theory of disease causation wouldn't fly, because there was Koch's postulates, which said if an agency causes a disease in the disease itself, that agent must always be present. And it all said that if that agent is caused to the disease, its presence must always occasion the disease. Well, this is demonstrably false. For instance, in actual AIDS cases, people in the hospital and dying of it, only less than 50% of them had the so-called AIDS virus, which is a weak form of a retrovirus. Anyway, they have found, they say, 1.5 million people in this country with the AIDS virus. That's the estimate.
Yes.
And they say they're living under Damocles' sword, and it's just a matter of when they get it and when they die. But the truth is, they don't have the virus. What they have is a so-called antibody to the virus. And if you remember the rationale for getting vaccinated, is so the body will create antibodies and you'll be immune to the disease for which you have the antibodies. Well, here they've done a switch in their rationale, and now having the antibodies means that you're subject to getting the disease. That's some flip-flop, if you will, but I mean, they don't think the American people are thinkers. They take them for suckers, and that's the way they've been.
I want to try to clarify a point.
Yes.
I have read in some of your literature, one of your books, that a virus is really not alive but is dead. It is a dead substance, and a dead substance. Why don't you pursue
okay.
that
and all right.
let us know exactly what a virus itself is and whether in fact it plays any part in disease.
Right. A virus, so-called, is always dead. There's no such thing as a live virus. Even the so-called live viruses means they were obtained from live tissue instead of dead tissue. But viruses, so-called, are actually genomes. Now, a genome is the genetic material. And if you look at a cell in your body, you have about 100 trillion of them. And each cell has a nucleus. And these nucleuses disintegrate when the cells disintegrate. There are lysosomes which dissolve the cell. And of course, they do not do a thorough job, and the actual nucleus of the cell is well protected. And in degenerating it, it may not completely destroy that nucleus, which is the genome for a cell. That is where the chromosomes, the genetic material, is housed. If it's not destroyed, it just floats in the system, and it's called a cytomegalovirus. But something that most people don't realize is each cell has from maybe 20, 30 to 40,000 mitochondria in each cell. A cell is a little walled-in city, and it has these residents there as independent forms of life, just like bacteria, an independent form. In fact, they're no larger than a bacterium. So when the cell is destroyed, these mitochondria are also destroyed, and each mitochondrion has a genome. That's a control center. A genome is to a mitochondrion, or organelles, which they're called, what the brain is to the human body. It's a control mechanism.
Okay.
It has the blueprint whereby that mitochondrion creates our energy from glucose. It has the blueprint for making specialized proteins that the cell and even the body needs. These mitochondrions are really the basic unit of life. They have collected together, and they have a protected environment called a cell. And of course, cells have united together, and they have a protected environment called a body. But when the cells die, and we have maybe 300 to 500 billion cells dying every day and being replaced at the same rate as a rule, the dead cells disintegrate. When you figure it out, if there's, say, 500 billion cells a day dying, and each one has 20,000 shall we say, mitochondrion dying. Well, you have several quadrillion, maybe a quintillion of genomes that are involved. And if those that survive or don't get completely destroyed, they're dead, yes, but they just float around in the system. Now, there are processes called pinocytosis and phagocytosis, whereby cells recycle the body's own waste. The body's own waste are very subject to use. It's not an alien material, and it all it does is the cell takes it in, it actually invaginates, it becomes a little dent in it, and then it envelops the material, and it forms an impromptu stomach, and lysosomes, again, go in and digest this material and break it down into the proteins, the amino acids, and the fats into simple fatty acids or monoglycerides and glycerols, and then the cell can use it. It reconstitutes it into its own materials. So what they're calling a genome is that material which floats around that came out of mitochondria, but they're calling them viruses. After all, the system is based on drugs, and it needs scapegoats in order to justify the system. They're sending the drugs in to destroy these so-called things. Never mind that the drugs destroy the human being more than they destroy anything else, and dead material don't have to be destroyed, it's already dead.
When you say the system now, are you talking about the body mechanism or about people?
When I'm talking about the system, I'm really talking about the medical system.
Okay, all right.
The cartel. Which controls it, right.
All right.
They need scapegoats. And when you have disease, they want you to use their representatives, which are called physicians and hospitals and clinics. They want you to go there and get treated, because these people are trained drug peddlers. They don't realize it, but they are sophisticated in drug dispensing. They've been taught that. They're not taught about health in the medical schools. They're taught about dispensing drugs. The drugs, the pharmaceutical houses, they need drug peddlers. And what they do is elevate trained medical men and women to a high station. They give them semi-divinity, and whatever they say goes, because they know that the medical profession will dispense their drugs that way. Now, you know about medical societies. If someone wants to go and get people healthy and not dispense drugs, they get kicked out and they lose their license, because the system is set up to serve the drug industry and not to serve the people. I've had several MDs take our course. And I've had one in Idaho who started fasting people, giving them raw diets and more fruits. And for not dispensing drugs, he was kicked out of the society. Well, he kept on practicing. And they hauled him in for violating the Medical Practices Act. And the judge told him if he so much as prescribed a glass of water to anyone hereafter, he would be hauled into jail. So he can't even prescribe a glass of water for a dying man.
But now, Dr. Fry, that is a very serious serious charge.
Well, it's serious if you're into the racket and don't want to be shown up. But if for people who are out there listening to this who have no vested interest in medicine or pharmaceutical interest, hey, this should be very serious. It should be the best news they've had.
But how can you say to the person who wakes up every morning and cannot live without an aspirin, or the person whose closet is full of medications given by the family doctor, and the family doctor who's trusted himself, who writes the prescription, how can you convince my public out there that all of these people are in some sort of undeclared conspiracy to do them harm?
Oh, gosh, I'm surprised that our ancestors in nature ever made it at all. I'm surprised that people in tribes in Africa get along at all, because, hey, they don't have any physicians, drugs, or anything. They live as foragers and hunters.
Well, you know, it did occur to me that there are no veterinarians out in the plains, are there?
That's correct, and the animals get along just fine, don't they? Healthy, never diseased and sick. And of course, when man takes over and dictates the diet of the animal, he gets sick and they take him to a vet and he makes him sicker.
That's a lot of food for thought. But I want to go back. Now I want to go back to a couple of famous people. Rock Hudson.
Yes.
And Liberace.
Yes.
Based on statements that you've made, it would appear that both Rock Hudson and Liberace were users or abusers of drugs.
Yes, they could have been that. But remember, they were very rich.
Yes.
And they availed themselves of a lot of medical treatments. And the medical treatments in themselves are immunosuppressive and deadly.
Explain that a little bit. Now, you say medical treatments. If it's not drugs, then what else might it be that
medical
could
treatments,
depress the immune system?
Medical treatments do rely on heavy use of drugs. In fact, almost no medical treatment doesn't involve drugs. Now, you all remember Christian Bernard and
yes,
and the people he treated in South Africa and heart transplants. Well, those people died of AIDS, and they described their life after heart transplant as living hell, because what he did was to give them immunosuppressive drugs so that they would not reject the heart. Well, these immunosuppressive drugs actually destroy white blood cells, which would destroy alien organisms in the body, and they recognize someone else's heart as an alien protein, an alien organism, it will destroy it. So they give drugs to inhibit that destruction, and of course that is the key for making heart transplants, is to keep it from being rejected, because rejected you'll die.
But you just said that they died of AIDS.
But they died of AIDS instead, right, because they were pumped full of immunosuppressive drugs.
But isn't that inconsistent though with your thesis?
No, it's not consistent. Look, AIDS is only an acronym that applies to diseases that have been around and have actually been in the medical literature for over 400 years.
I see. So you're using the term as it is commonly used, not as a description of what
That's correct. In using the term AIDS, we understand that to mean an immunodeficiency syndrome. Incidentally, I told you a while ago that immunodeficiency syndrome is in the Merck manual and has been for about 45 years or so. But there's also acquired immunodeficiency disease in there. And this merely meant that you got it after birth. If you were born with it, and that's agammaglobulinemia, it is called congenital. And congenital immunodeficiency, and if you got it after, it's called acquired. That's what the way, it didn't mean it was contagious, but the Centers for Disease Control present the context as if it were, because without contagion, the medical system is dead. That concept is central to it, as are some of the other concepts like infection and things of this nature.
Now, Dr. Fry, I know that you're not a psychologist or a psychiatrist and you don't practice psychology.
No.
But I got to ask you this question, because there are a lot of people out there watching this program right now who actually believe that a friend of theirs has AIDS, or in fact that they themselves have AIDS. Now, when a person believes that he has a disease, how many comment on that? What is the real situation with that person?
Well, sometimes the depressing effect of a belief can cause what's called psychosomatic disease, but it really doesn't have all that much physical effect that you imagine. It's just that the body fakes it, and the real condition of the body, the physicians will never discover anything. It's all in your mind, and it's literally true in the case of psychosomatic disease. However, when it comes to diseases, and you actually get AIDS and things, it's not something that happened in your mind, it's something that happened inside your body that actually caused it. And usually it's a drug, and it can be a recreational drug. Any drug causes the white blood cells to act like a suicide squadron and going into the body, apprehending the material and getting it out. And it can destroy the white blood cells themselves. And if it's very, very virulent, that is poisonous, like heroin and things of this nature, it can destroy your white blood cell complement very speedily. I mean, it's well known that heroin, people often die. They call it overdose because it continually increases. But what it does is just increasingly destroy their white blood cell complement, such that they're unprotected and they get into what they call these opportunistic diseases, because the body must extraordinarily eliminate this garbage, which the white blood cells didn't do because they were destroyed.
You have said, and correct me if I have heard you incorrectly, you have said that all drugs work to destroy the body's immune system.
That's correct.
You have said that drugs are a lot broader in their actuality than the street drugs, though the heroin, the cocaine, the things that people normally think of as drugs. I want you to imagine an ordinary dinner table or an ordinary kitchen in an American household. And I want you to describe the drugs that you see and confirm that those two are just as much killers as the cocaine, the heroin, that a drug is a drug is a drug. If that's what you're saying, look into an American kitchen and describe what drugs you see.
Yeah, okay. I have a book at home, and it's diet, cancer, and nutrition, or diet, nutrition, and cancer. And it actually catalogs hundreds and hundreds of cancer-causing agents that people eat every day. Heated fats came in for a lot of this, and it especially said to be responsible for bowel cancer, which kills a lot of people in this country. And it spoke of heated fats. It also spoke of proteins that have been heated. Now, we know that proteins that have been heated cannot be used by the body. So when you cook your meat, that rare part may be intact enough that your body can break it down to amino acids and absorb it. But that which has been heated and deranged, it becomes coagulated. You can see this happen very quickly in the case of heated cheese and heated eggs. Well, you can no longer get any amino acids out of that. The bacteria will break this down as organic materials. And the byproducts of bacterial putrefaction, that's what happens to proteins, is such things as ammonias, mercaptans, skatols, indols, phenols, tomaines, leucomaines, and a raft of other poisons, which if the body absorbs them, intoxicate you. And the average American is a very intoxicated person. You may not agree with me, but all I have to do is put you on a fast, and within 24 hours, your tongue will coat up so much you think a snowstorm hit it. This is merely a symptom of body detoxification. And you can't detoxify unless you have toxins in the system. The average American, as I say, goes from 10 to 60 poisoning acts a day. And on their tables, there's cooked foods. Cooked foods contain a lot of deranged substances, like deranged proteins, deranged carbohydrates, deranged fats. They're carcinogenic. And the minerals in these substances are deranged, and they're especially toxic. This is demonstrable by the fact that if you have a resting white blood cell count of, say, 5,000, and you eat a cooked meal with condiments and everything, your white blood cell count within an hour may be up to 12 or 15,000, which means this, that the toxins from this cooked meal and perhaps from foods that's contrary to your biological disposition are absorbed into the bloodstream, and the white blood cells proliferate from the capillary basis where they're stored and from the lymph system and from the bone marrow. They go out and proliferate like an army that's discovered and attacked an enemy, and they surround, capture this toxic debris and take it to the nearest exit. That's what they're there for. So that the average American, as I say, eats cooked foods, and that is quite toxic. Then, of course, they use a lot of condiments. Well, most condiments are outright poison. And of course, they drink a lot of soft drinks. Soft drinks occasion increases in the body's white blood cell count because of the poisons. And then, of course, there is hard water that we drink, the water from the tap, which has minerals in it. Well, the body can't use those minerals, and it occasions toxic reactions. You see, there are so many ways in which the American person takes in drugs outright or eats fare that's contrary to their biological disposition, and they get sick because of it.
One final question, and our audience has to leave us. Can a person get AIDS from sexual contact?
Never.
Thank you. Thank you. Dr. T.C. Fry has been my guest. We have been discussing AIDS, the Big Hoax, on Organic Wellness Crusade. I'm Dr. Henry Allen Anderson, your host, and we'll hope you can join us next time.